Zigzag in One, a place where we honestly discuss how to navigate the zigs and zags in our crazy lives. Expect heartwarming stories, some laughter, and maybe a few tears as we embrace life's challenges and choose joy over a momentary defeat. Today, we will hear from someone whose life has had some unexpected turns, but chose to keep moving forward. What did they learn? Some valuable life lessons. Zigs and zags are also a part of our host, Melanie Brown's journey. She too had to find the determination to never give up. What are we waiting for? Let's dive in.
Welcome to the Zigzag in One podcast. I'm your host, Melanie Brown. Today's episode is going to be a tough listen, and it definitely is not recommended for children. My guest, Hannah Gavios, was sexually assaulted and suffered extensive injuries while on a vacation in Thailand. She shares her pain and she shares her incredibly strong overcomer attitude. This young woman has not let a horrible experience stop her. Hannah is a packing design assistant for the clothing retailer Ralph Lauren and a yoga instructor. She dreams of summiting Mount Kilimanjaro and traveling the world. Based on what she's already accomplished, I have no doubt she'll do it. Please join my conversation with Hannah Gavios. Earlier this year, I ran across a story that caught my attention because of the extremely difficult circumstances a young woman named Hannah faced, as well as how it significantly impacted her life. Her focus could have been on all she'd lost, but she's a fighter. So instead, her focus was on setting goals and meeting them. At this point, 5 years after the night her attacker disrupted her life, Hannah has crossed the finish line of the New York City Marathon 2 times, and she's training for the 3rd time for this fall. I am so eager for you to hear Hannah Gavios' story, but also hear her incredible attitude as she shares what she's learned during this journey. So welcome, Hannah.
Hi, thank you.
I'm so excited about spending time with you today.
Me too. It's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Well, we have to start off with the difficult part first. Let's jump in and talk about where you were when you were about 23 years old.
Yeah, so I graduated college. I studied graphic design, and I was working a 9-to-5 job, and then I decided I needed a change. So I hopped on a plane, went to Southeast Asia, did some traveling throughout Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam, and then I was working as an English teacher for about a month in Vietnam until I decided to go back to Thailand. And that's when my entire world turns upside down.
Yes, it did. To talk about what happened when you made that short visit to Vietnam. So set the stage for us and tell us about that day.
So I was working in Vietnam, and then when I went to Thailand, right?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes.
Yeah, so I went there to find peace. I was working all day long, every day, teaching about like 60 kids a day. And I just needed to like find some inner peace and inspiration. And so I packed my yoga mat and my sketchbook and some colored pencils. And, you know, I just thought like, wow, I'm just going to be in this like beautiful place in paradise, with like monkeys in the trees and beautiful art murals everywhere. And that's exactly how it was. It was like the most peaceful, beautiful place that I traveled to. There were a lot of backpackers, and a lot of them were like rock climbing on a lot of the walls of the cliffs. And it was just like a really nice, like laid back vibe. And I didn't really think anything wrong could happen there. Traveling 16 hours without sleep, I was in like a very remote part of Vietnam where there are no airports. Went out and got some food, and then I tried to make my way back to my hotel, and that's where I got lost, and a local offered to help. Yeah, he led me off a cliff, and he attacked me, so that's when I ran for my life, and in the process of doing so, I was in panic and I fell 150 feet off of a cliff and landed with a broken back. I was screaming on the top of my lungs and I felt like a newborn all over again. I really thought I was going to die that night.
I can't imagine. You go to this other country to spend time, to have some solitude, to have some beauty, to reconnect and take care of yourself. You go out to dinner, you get lost, you need some help from someone. This gentleman offers to help you. He is not a good guy.
And yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. When I read your story a couple of months ago, I just could not even believe the terror that you must have felt. You put your trust in this person. Yes, it was a stranger, but you felt you could put your trust in him and for him to guide you back to where you needed to go. He took advantage of that. Yeah. What was going through your mind as all of this was happening?
As all of it was happening, it really felt like a whole out-of-body experience. Like I was honestly thinking about like other people that have gone through similar experiences. Like, you know, a lot of women who've been abused, and it was kind of like hard to believe that I was going through this firsthand. When I was falling, like I really felt like, wow, I'm only 23, and like I can't believe that my life is coming to an end. And then I thought about like all my friends and family back at home. I was like wondering if they would ever discover me or what happened to me. But then I felt like, you know, sort of bliss for being able to experience all the things that I had up into that age. It was a lot of emotions. It really was. And then when I felt like horrible, I felt like, you know, useless, vegetable. Like, you know, I had like a lot of depressing thoughts because I honestly felt like, you know, very unlucky to have survived something like that. You know, now I feel completely different for a reason.
Did you feel the pain when you fell those 150 feet? Did you feel the immediate pain or?
Yeah, it was like a shocking, echoing pain that I can't even describe because it was just so overwhelming. Like I didn't know what to do with that pain. It was a lot. Yeah, it was at night, and I just remember like screaming on the top of my lungs and hearing like my echoes out into a distance. Yeah.
And I didn't see, but this person did not come to help you.
Well, he came down the cliff and then he assaulted me while I was paralyzed. So,
oh my goodness.
Like it can't get any worse. Well, it can, like all hours of the night. And then once it got light out, during dawn, he actually left and came back with help.
Okay, so he got help for you. Yeah. And this was approximately how long after you fell?
At least 8 hours.
Goodness. Oh my goodness. Let's fast forward to the hospital. What was the doctor's diagnosis of your injuries? What did they say was wrong?
So I broke T12 of my spine. They told me I was partially paralyzed below the waist, so below the level of my injury. So I'm classified now as like an L3 patient. So meaning like everything, the lower lumbar spine and below is partially affected. So I can't feel the backside of my legs or my ankles or my calves. I can't move my feet or my toes. Like one of the biggest struggles I have right now is crow toe. When your toes, a lot of the time, when they can't move, like slowly and maturely, they start folding until the point where they're like this. So then when I'm walking, it's like I'm tripping over myself or stepping on myself. Right now I have to buy the right shoes and the right things that are comfortable for my body changes.
I can't even imagine. I'm just so sorry to hear how such a young person had to go through such trauma and then the outcome of it. What were your thoughts when you were given that diagnosis? Did you immediately shut down? Did you say, I'm going to fight through this? Because I know I'm interviewing you because you have that overcomer fighter spirit, but we all know that it doesn't just happen immediately. Like that's something that you have to come around to, or maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you heard the doctor's words and said, oh no, I will walk again. So which is it?
A lot of it was just disbelief in the very beginning because I was able to walk pretty soon after my injury, luckily. I was never really in a wheelchair. I was a little bit.
Wow.
But I was able to take some steps about 2 weeks after my injury. Not very good steps, but they were steps.
That's impressive, though.
Yeah, yeah. I got really, really lucky. But then I also worked really hard for it, too. And they told me that, like, it takes the spinal cord about a centimeter a month to regenerate. And they were also, like, not really promising a full recovery. I asked them questions like, will I ever feel my feet again? And I thought they were like, oh, yeah, of course. Like, why wouldn't you? But they were like, I don't know. So it was just all this uncertainty. And they were saying that, like, you know, this recovery, like, I'm going to have the most recovery within the first 6 months. And then after 2 years, there won't really be more recovery. And so I didn't really believe any of that. I was just like, nah, like, you know, this isn't that serious. Like, I'm going to recover in 3 months and be perfectly back to normal. I didn't get it. I didn't understand paralysis or the spine or any of that stuff. Like, this was like a whole new world for me. My surgeon in Thailand, like, he actually did connect me with one of his American patients that he operated on. Mine is a lot more severe. He was like a tour guide, a hiker tour guide for a living. And I think he broke his back from climbing one of those cliffs in the same place where I fell. And now he's hiking again, but he doesn't need like crutches or canes or anything to walk. You know, you meet all these people, but you can never compare yourself because everyone's completely different.
Right.
Yeah.
100% right. We can't compare because we can get very discouraged very quickly if we do. So let's talk about, you were in the hospital for how long?
So I was in the hospital in Thailand for about 17 days. Yeah, that's where I spent most of my recovery in the ICU. And I had all these different specialists. I was doing physical therapy and I was in a hyperbaric chamber and all that fun stuff. And then once they felt like I was okay to be a little more independent, then my health insurance, actually Oscar at the time, giving them a shout out, my parents were with me in Thailand, and they actually not only paid for all the hospital expenses in Thailand, but they also paid for 3 first class tickets with Emirates. The hospital staff, like, they were saying, like, I needed to lie down. I was still bedridden at the time. So I couldn't be like in a normal chair. I had to be lying down. It was very long, but very nice. Then I arrived in New York and I was in the hospital in Mount Sinai for about 2 months. I was an inpatient where I was doing physical therapy, like about 6 hours a day. And then they discharged me right around Thanksgiving.
But you had some serious injuries that you needed to work through and you needed the professionals to help you. It's not something that you can take on your own and make the progress in the time that you have, because what you have been able to accomplish since that day is incredible.
I give a lot of credit to all the physical therapists and occupational therapists I worked with in Mount Sinai.
When we're going through our struggles, we don't need negativity. We need positive thoughts, words, encouragement. Doesn't need to be Pollyanna, doesn't need to be fake, but it does need to be positive.
Right.
And I know that mindset is extremely important when we're going through struggles.
Luckily, like, I got to do some therapy outside in Central Park, which also is where I witnessed the New York City Marathon, which we could get to later. And I'm really happy that eventually I got out of the hospital so that I could experience even more challenges that were not allowed inside the hospital, you know, due to liabilities and things like that.
Sure. So you did mention that you had time out in Central Park and you got to see the marathon. Is that something that you've done before? Have you been a runner? Have you been an athlete? What was it about watching it that interested you, inspired you?
Yeah. So I've been a runner my whole life. I was on the track team in high school. Running is like always something that I did as an active meditation and also to stay in shape and be healthy. And I would run a lot during my travels. And it's just like a way that I got to explore and see a new place. I find that like when you're running, as opposed to driving a car, for example, like you get to take in, you know, everything around you at a much slower pace. So I saw the runners doing the marathon when I was hardly able to even cross the street at the time in a walker. And I was just like, wow, like it wasn't so long that I was able to just move my feet in that graceful fashion. And now I can't even like cross the street without getting hit by a car. So I felt like a little, you know, jealous and bitter and angry. And I felt a lot of resentment, like why me, and all those negative, vicious thoughts.
Sure. But yeah. Obviously it didn't last long because you made the decision to train for it and run it. And if I have my notes correct, 2 years after the attack, you ran the New York City Marathon, which is unbelievable.
Thank you. Yeah. As I was really fighting in my recovery to gain as much function back as I could, I came to a point in my recovery where I was like, you know, let's face it, like what happened to me is crazy. And I'm never going to return to the same body ever again. Like I had to throw that thought out the window. Like I'm never going to be able to like walk or run in the same way that I did before, because I've been through so much. It's not possible to go back and pretend that didn't happen. But what I could do is move forward with what I have, maybe gain some strength that I never achieved before. I was starting to do like headstands. I started doing a lot of very advanced yoga poses that I've never been able to do before my injury, only because like I gained so much upper body strength from crutching around that like I was actually able to like stand on my head. And I was just like, you know what, if I can't stand upright, like I'm just gonna live my world upside down.
So, I love it.
Yeah. So it's like I kind of like, it was my rebirth. It was my chance to like rediscover myself. And I became inspired by other people with similar mindsets. My sister found this girl, Amanda, and she ran the New York City Marathon in 9 hours on crutches. She had like brain injuries and spinal cord injuries, and this girl's been through a lot. And so she, among others, really inspired me that while like, you know, there's not just like one way of running, there's so many ways that you can accomplish a race. And luckily it wasn't like this, like 30, 40, 50 years ago, but now like the New York City Marathon, New York Roadrunners, they make their races very welcoming to so many different types of people, which is really great. Like, you know, when you're doing a marathon, you see so many types of people running it, people running on prosthetics.
It had to have been encouraging to have all those people on the sidelines. I know when they saw you and what you were doing, they had to have been cheering like crazy, which gives you fuel to keep going, right?
Definitely. Definitely. But remember, the first year I was out there for 11 hours and 20 minutes. So
that's some perseverance and endurance, girl.
Thank you. So the last half of the race was actually quite lonely until the finish line. The whole first half of the race was full of crowds, full of cheering, like which really helped a lot. Even like not just the people on the sidelines, but even like the runners in the race. They would turn around, give me a high five, give me a thumbs up, a lot of positive vibes. But then after a certain point, it's like, okay, everyone finish. And like, we're the only ones out there. So it gets kind of lonely and it's dark. And you really have to like push yourself because no one else is out there to do it for you. But then to be welcomed by all those crowds, that was the best surprise party of my entire life, because I really thought like at that point, like everyone's home, everyone's taking like a warm bath. I'm like, I hope there's a finish line. I hope there's at least one volunteer to give me a medal. I really like the first year, I didn't expect anyone there. And to see like 1,000 people cheering me on was just really heartwarming.
I can only imagine. But what I'm hearing when you're saying that, of all those hours that you had to do it by yourself without the crowds there and in the dark and all of that, that tells me a lot about your inner strength. That tells me that when you set your mind to something, you're going to make it happen. And I love that attitude. And that's why you've done this now twice and you're training for a third time. It's not like a one and done. I needed to accomplish that. Like, this is something that's important to you. So tell me about what other goals you have for your future.
Well, like you said earlier, I have my third marathon coming up. I would like to maybe hike some of those seven wonders that we discussed earlier, maybe do Mount Kilimanjaro. And I'm going to write a book. So that's one of my big goals.
Fantastic.
I've never written a book before. And to be honest, I'm quite intimidated. You know, I wish I wrote it much sooner. But here I am 5 years later saying I'm going to write a book.
Those 5 years that you've been waiting to write and haven't, you've been gaining wisdom. Yeah. That's going to be important for you to include in your book, because what you've learned by what you've gone through is extremely valuable to other people who are also struggling, which is why we do the podcast. People likely have not gone through exactly what you've gone through, but when they hear what you've gone through and the determination and the mindset that you have and the positivity that you have, then they can say, my situation is difficult, but if she can do it, then I can do it.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's easy to like stay in that like vicious cycle of negative thinking. And I think it's okay to have that for yourself. It's okay to have like those moments where you grieve and, you know, you feel down and you're upset. But then after a certain point, like you have to like step out of it and move forward, because there's so much beauty around us. Like there is so much to really be grateful in this world. Like it's not just like our sorrow or the bad things that happen to us, because in reality, our experience in life, they're just experiences. They don't define us. They're just part of who we are.
I think that is beautiful, Hannah. I love what you're saying. Because yes, we're going to have our rough days, but we can't live there. We got to keep moving forward. We got to keep pursuing the things that are on our heart and that we're passionate about.
You can't control everything in the world. Like there's always going to be like bad people and negative people. And like, you just can't get caught up in all that drama. You just got to take a deep breath and just be okay with the fact that the world isn't perfect.
Mm-hmm. Correct. But as you said, we can see so much beauty in it. And there's so many things that we can live our lives for that are positive.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's time for us to end. That just like flew by because there was just so much to ask you. But I wanted to make sure before we finish that we talk about what your one takeaway is for the listeners, the thing that is so important to you that they remember about your interview. So what would that be?
I think the one takeaway in life is just to keep on going, focus on the things that you want to achieve and the things that you're really, really passionate about in life. Just keep going until you achieve those things. Like you're going to get a lot of no's along the way and a lot of rejections, and you're probably going to fail many, many times, and that's okay. Every time you fail, just keep picking yourself back up and keep moving forward, because one day you are going to get that yes, you will succeed.
I absolutely love it. Well, Hannah, it has been a pleasure to spend time with you today, and thank you so much for sharing your story. I want to know when you cross that finish line again. I want a picture. Will you text it to me?
I will. I'll share the photo with you November 7th.
Fantastic. I'm going to put it on my calendar.
Awesome. Well,
thank you, Hannah.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Wow, just incredible. I'm inspired by Hannah's attitude. I believe her story is so powerful because it reminds us that no matter what challenges we face in life and how they impact us, we can fight to overcome, and we can learn valuable lessons that will strengthen us, and we can still live fully even if it looks different. I cannot wait to see the pictures of Hannah crossing the finish line of the New York City Marathon for the third time in November. Please join me on September the 11th for a special tribute on the 20th anniversary of 9/11. Until then, when life zigs and zags, and you know it will, keep moving forward.